Welcome to our segment tonight. I'm glad that you're tuning in with us. Nehemiah's story continues. We've covered some really cool points, how God starts with a burden in the heart of an eye, a person, one. Maybe that's you for your life where you have the biggest fights right now, but it starts with an eye, and God gives you a burden, becomes an us. You have to bring others in on it. So you got this us, and then make great plans in the wisdom of God and seek out his wisdom and assess things correctly. And then be a great leader. Be willing to do what is necessary. Be ahead. Look ahead. Look after people and look out for the best welfare that you can and lead this thing well. And you're going to find that you're going to accomplish some pretty big things. Now the story, guys. The opposition, we start off with them again, and it looks like they're just kind of keep ratcheting things up.
That's right. Last episode, we had got to verse 6, where it said they had built the wall up to halfway with great enthusiasm, with all their heart. And of course, now there's success in their plan, and the enemy is even more angry. The enemy is more threatened, and so the threats ramp up. It goes from words to where this is actually going to be quite an attack. And so in verse 7, it starts just saying that Sanballat and the enemies had seen the work, and they were furious. So there's this escalation of anger, and then they call out to people who were formerly their enemies, who they would have fought against, and got them to all gather around this evil plan, basically, the negative, right? And I think in life, when you're in a negative place or you see someone else in a negative place, it's not hard to find people who will gather around that, who will become the negative us, or in this case, the evil us.
So they are forming an us.
Yeah.
From tribes that normally are at war with one another.
Yes.
Cheating and lying to each other and all this, but they come together around this negative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's some pretty heavy danger when an us or an evil becomes an us, right? This isn't no longer fox jokes on a wall. This is a genuine evil now. When an us forms and is organized and developed in that sort of a way, that could be a real threat.
And it was a real threat. Mm-hmm. Like, we're talking about they were going to attack.
Yeah, they went from just, you know, chirping to, like, we're gonna fight against them now.
Yeah, they've got a battle plan. Mm-hmm. So they're going to battle. They're going to kill them. In fact, they say, we're going to kill them because the work is. And there's a cool phrase here where it says verse 7, they were ahead. They had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed. Mm-hmm. They were very angry. So they see the walls actually becoming functional. You remember fox joke you guys had so much fun with? Well, they're seeing that they're really building walls.
Yeah, this is real now.
This is happening. Functional, and the gaps are getting closed. Mm-hmm. Like, our opportunity to destroy this work, really, in this case, a work of God, has got to happen now. They come together around that negative. They get a battle plan. They're ready to go and draw their swords. Mm-hmm. A blood bath could be coming.
And in verse 8, it actually says, they all made plans to come and fight against Jerusalem. So this is the city of God. I mean, the arrogance of these enemies to think that they stand a chance against God is what they're saying.
I hear you, but even like over the past several years, the city had been decimated and these guys did have power. So what they didn't understand is that God had brought his people back and he really was in charge. I think they probably just thought, their God's not really. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Look how they've been living the last while.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's like at this point now, the fear is real. It's not a rational fear. This is genuine fear, but there's also a huge reassurance knowing that, like you see it right from the beginning of the story, Nehemiah said, God sent me here. This is God's plan. It's not just my plan. So as scary and as real as that evil is, there's a huge truth that they're coming up against a God that is the one true God. So, you know, it kind of reassures that fear, right? There's a real safety in the real fear.
And that's pretty cool because you end up, I think people wonder how to manage these kinds of things in their lives, these kinds of threats, whatever. There are genuine threats, but our assurance comes from the presence of God, right? And it comes from a plan of God. I covered that on Sunday. Well, you listen to Sunday morning if you didn't. But it comes from those anchors in our life. And we can respond to these real threats that are coming our way. And they did.
Yeah. And you, if you look at Nehemiah the whole way through, he always prays for a way forward. And like in all these times, he isn't praying for a way out after it happens, right? Mm. So I think in so many ways, and especially in our lives, we try to, you know, do it on our own way as long as we can. And then finally when we're belly up, that's when we're like, God, get me out of here. Right. But Nehemiah is an amazing leader. And you see it every step of the way that he trusts God and then he finds the way, right?
Mm-hmm. So this really was a working relationship with God. It wasn't just a rescue relationship with God.
Right.
Like he could work with God's plans because it's not a rescue relationship only.
Yeah, it was an active working. Yeah.
Yeah, in verse 9, so right after he says that they've made these plans, it says, but we prayed to our God and guarded the city day and night to protect ourselves. So they prayed and then they changed up their plan.
Two things. Yeah, pray and then acted. Pray and then acted. Yeah.
So then it goes on to say that the people of Judah begin to complain. They're getting physically tired. They're seeing the impossibilities. There's so much rubble to be moved. We'll never be able to build these walls by ourselves. And as previously noted, they were at this halfway point. So I think it's important for us to know when we're making our plans that a halfway point can be that time when we lose our steam. We've had a motivation going in, and we're going to have a different motivation at the end. But in that middle point, it can be easy to start to refocus on the impossibilities. And I think even with what's going on right now in our world, you know, we're kind of, some of us are at this halfway point. The shock of what's been happening has worn off. We're starting to make this our new normal. And it can be easy to lose that motivation to keep rebuilding.
Very much. Mm-hmm. This is a low point.
Yeah.
The lowest point. And halfway points are interesting in every faction of life, aren't they? Can you think of other halfway points that we experience certain things at?
I picture Brent in his van with all them kids maybe going on a little trip somewhere.
Family road trip to Edmonton. Who doesn't get tuckered right around White Court and start going to the, get the iPads in the back, guys. Stop at McDonald's. Let's get some fries happening. Yeah,
you don't pick up some tots in White Court, you ain't making it to Edmonton.
That's right.
Yes. The are we there yet starts coming out.
Yeah. Ramps at a new
They're great
level.
At the front
a
end.
New level, yeah.
Back end, no problem of the journey. It's always that middle part. Yeah. But that goes for literally everything. And you right now might be really at a halfway point. At a lot of things. You've been working hard. You made some good starts. You started some good things. But you're getting really tired. Well, Nehemiah does some interesting things here to actually restore motivation in the halfway point. And I'm going to read it first, and then you guys jump all over it.
Sure.
Also, our enemy said, before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and we'll kill them and put an end to the work. All of this is happening at the halfway point. Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. Now, this is an interesting thing because it's saying there was a sector of Jews. They lived really near the enemy. So they were living near the enemy. And they were bringing the enemy's voice. And they said, like 10 times over. It's like they just kept talking all these fear points.
Right.
Right? Just kept bringing all the fear points. You know, that is really discouraging when the people that you're supposed to be working side by side with can talk nothing but fear. And that's what these guys that live near the enemy. And we have to be cautious again about the voices we let into that core and into that center of our life. Because they might be bringing fear points to you all the time. And that's what was going on here. And therefore I stationed. Now here's where I want to. Now here's what Nehemiah does. Therefore I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows. Okay, something's happened here dramatic.
Totally. They've made this huge shift from a building plan to a war plan. So it's, and he stations them with the family, which who among us wouldn't fight to the end for our family? So at this point, really, I know the enemies have meant this for bad, but really it's been used for good because they were losing their motivation. Nehemiah switched the plan. He didn't just try, okay, guys, head down. Let's keep carrying through. Let's keep, you know, doing our project.
Work faster.
Yeah. No, he knew that things needed to change. So he changed to a war plan for protection, put these people near their families because he knew that they would fight hard for their families. And as you had mentioned previously, what the enemies didn't know is that they were rebuilding the heart of the people. These people had gone from a slavery or a victim mentality, and they were going to need to change that mentality, to change that heart. And this is happening here, right? They're taking ownership over this building project. Now they have to fight for their families and for themselves. You know,
that's such a core motivation for all of us.
Totally.
Is, you know, when we're fighting for our family.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know about you, but that's when the blood's going to run the hottest. That's when all of that. I mean, you hear about a mom, you know, rescuing a kid from a cougar. I mean, that was that report out of BC just a couple of years back. Yeah. And Christian mom, by the way, that how she actually dealt with a cougar that had her kid.
Mama bear.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. Like, I mean, you're talking about, like, that's your core motivation. And he uses that at the halfway, the lowest point, to say, don't forget what you're fighting for.
Yeah.
There's too much at stake. This is the value. This is your future. This is your generations. These are the things that you live for anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So fight the hardest for these things.
Mm-hmm.
And then he comes back and then he says this: after I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, and your daughters, your wives, and your homes.
Ooh, yeah.
So he says, don't be afraid. But then he says something. He says, remember.
Mm.
And what did they remember? Remember that God's been faithful. Remember the fights that you've been through. Remember what's really important to you. Remember these things. Remember the goodness of God in your own life, in your generations before you. Remember the acts of God.
Mm-hmm.
Remember what he's done. And then he comes back and he says, now, you're going to fight for, and Ethan's going to just kind of wind this segment up for us.
Yeah, you have to really admire Nehemiah, especially at this point in the story. When you look at how well he's in tune with all these people that he's working with. I think that the end of this story could have, that we're concluding today, could have gone two ways, like we said, where they build the walls and they hide behind them, or we put down the stones, we go out, and we, instead of protecting ourselves from the wolves, we chase the wolves away at this point. And like we said in the last chapter, is he sees that their heart is built, it's strong now, whereas before maybe it wasn't, but the heart is strong enough now that he's like, we can go out, we can fight, and we can defeat these guys, whereas maybe before they couldn't. And I can't help but think it's so funny in this portion, when we look before at the halfway point, you know, they were so tired they couldn't build the wall anymore. They're so tired they didn't want to keep going. And now not only are they going to build the wall, they're going to fight at the same time. They have three times the strength they thought they even had. It reminds me of a story like Elijah, where he sits at the tree and he thinks he's totally done and wiped out and that's the end. And then he gets up and walks 40 more days. You just can't help but see that when we put our focus back on God, we have so much more capability than we even realize.
So we need a war plan.
You need a war plan.
Not just a building plan.
That's right.
And your war plan is prayer. Your war plan is fight for the best in your life, the things that you treasure the most, the things that are the greatest blessings from God. Enjoy the next segment. See you tomorrow night.
Hi. Over the past several weeks, you've probably been bombarded by all kinds of information that might cause some people to allow fear to sort of take the driver's seat in life and keep them from doing some important things. And, you know, a lot of this stuff may not even come to pass. So what we want to do tonight is help lighten the load, bring some humor into your home. Enjoy this skit by the Skitguys. It's called Five Ways to Kill Fear.
Tom and Eddie, the Skitguys, here to help you to conquer your fear with five tips.
That's right. Number five, acknowledge your fear. Write it down. Get it out there.
Oh, do that, Tommy. Do that. That's a great idea, okay? Here's the thing. When you write down your fear, it kind of helps just squelch the fear. Tommy is going to show you right now that we all have this in common. We all have fears. This is Tommy's number one fear.
This is my number one fear. I've seen it happen to people, and it's tragic. I can't imagine what it would be like to...
Really?
So much skin.
Number four, realize that most of your fears don't even come true.
Yours did.
This isn't a fear.
Looks like it should have been.
When it comes to those fears, they don't really ever come true. Like, some people have a fear of garden gnomes coming alive in the middle of the night and destroying you.
What?
Yes, a bunch of people fear that.
I don't think so.
It's a legitimate fear.
Those little statues in people's yards.
Those evil statues in people's yards.
Oh, this is your fear. You're afraid of garden gnomes.
I'm not.
Yes,
no,
you
I'm
are.
Not. I'm not.
Look at you.
Me. No. Okay. Moving on. Number three, do the thing you fear.
Yes. Like stay the night in a yard filled with garden gnomes. No, it really is a good idea to do what you fear. In fact, Winston Churchill said, do the thing you fear and the death of fear is certain.
No, Winston Churchill didn't say that.
Hmm?
Emerson said that.
What?
Ralph Waldo Emerson said, do the thing you fear and the death of fear is certain.
How do you gnome that?
Well, I had a college class on and there was a, did you just say, how do I gnome that?
Yep.
Okay, you know what I'm curious about? I'm curious what it would look like if I shaved your head.
That's not funny.
I'm not laughing.
Number two, be curious.
Yeah, because when you're curious, you're not focusing on your fear. You're squelching your fear. You're opening the door for God's wonder. Curiosity does that.
Yeah, and you'll also find that curiosity did not kill the cat. It was that creepy kid across the street. There's someone to be afraid of.
You don't even be afraid of him. Because the number one way to conquer your fear is to trust in God. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, for the spirit of the Lord is not of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind.
Yep. In fact, I got you a little keepsake to help you remember that.
Thanks, buddy. That's what I like about this guy. He's always thinking of other people. Ah! So there you have it, friends. Go out there. Conquer your fear. Make that bucket list of things that you want to do and know that God is on your side because there is nothing that you have to be afraid of.
Say goodbye. in this moment, heaven's working everything for your good. So tell your heart to beat again and close your eyes.
Again, good evening. In our prayer segment, we're going to continue in Philippians chapter 4. This is the letter that basically Paul is really getting close to the end of his journey. He's walked through ups, downs, all arounds. I mean, his life's been jerked north, south, east, west. He's a guy that really carried it all. God said in his call to him, you're going to go through a lot in carrying out the ministry I've given to you. And God was true to his word. But here's what he states in Philippians 4, and listen as I read this part to you. I've learned by now to be quite content, whatever my circumstances. I'm just as happy with little as with much as with little. I've found the recipe for being happy, whether full or hungry, hands full or hands empty. Whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. Just leave that last part there, I think, and we just want to talk about that. Whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything. Now, if you just stopped it there, that would just be a nice thing to put on the wall. Nice little saying. Paul didn't build his life on sayings. He built his life on God's word and his promises and his work and his spirit. That's what he did. What changes it? He says, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. Now it's not a nice saying. Now it's scripture. Now it's God's word and God's promise and God's presence. Now all things are possible because of Jesus, all through Jesus. He's the one who makes me who I am. He's the one whose hand I rest. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. This is a presence psalm. It's a promise psalm. All of this is wrapped up in this kind of concept that it's not just nice little sayings that ends with, I can make it through anything. No, you can't. But you can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. And so tonight, we want to pray confidently in needing the Lord's strength, that he's going to strengthen you because not some nice little saying, but because he is the one who's making you who you are, and he can make you strong. He can make you confident. He can make you wise. He can make you, in a sense, peaceful. He can make you what you need to be. So Father, in prayer, we come to you now. We sure fall short. Your arm does not fall short. We don't live by nice little sayings. We live by your word. We live by that. There are many, Lord, the bread of life is your word that comes to us, and it feeds our soul, and we need the bread. And we thank you, Lord God, that we live by the power of that life-giving word that you give us. And tonight I pray you drop that into every heart, that the Holy Spirit would just drop into every heart that this is not a nice saying, just you on your own going to try and overcome some kind of big deal. That it is you that are making us who we are. You do make us powerful in the face of giants. You do make us powerful in the face of the odds that face us. You do care. You do carry. It's all about you. And so we ask that you'll just deepen our confidence tonight, that we'll have that same peace. I've learned. You come through. God comes through. Why would I be discontent? God always comes through. He comes through. And you're going to come through for each one of us that are involved in this prayer right now. We can trust your word, not a saying on the wall, but the word dropped into our hearts. And may it come alive for us and bring us strength. Jesus, you're with us. You're making us who we need to be, and we trust you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm praying for you. I really am. It has been a hard work of prayer, actually. I'm going to continue to pray for you. And I really am asking the Lord to give you what you need in these days and hours, that you would really feel his presence with you. We now have another great Kids Corner with Pastor Angela. I don't know about you, but these are great ways to finish off these segments. And I'm looking forward to this one. Pastor Angela, you're on.
Welcome back to Kids Corner. Pastor Angela here. I'm so happy to be with you again tonight. Tonight we've got a delicious dessert recipe. This one is really easy to make, but you'll be so impressed that you actually created this delicious dessert. So tonight we're going to make chocolate peanut butter cups. So all you need is a muffin tin lined with paper liners. I like to use parchment liners because they're kind of like wax paper. Things come off really easy. Nothing gets stuck. We've got about a cup of chocolate chips. I use semi-sweet because that's what we like in my house. And I've microwaved them in 30-second intervals. Every 30 seconds, I take it out and give it a stir and then put it back in for another 30 seconds until we get this nice melted consistency. And then I did the same thing with about a half a cup of peanut butter. And now we've got this nice, easily pourable peanut butter. And that's all the ingredients you need for this. Now, before you get started, ask your parents for permission. Like always, I want you to be as safe as you can in the kitchen. So check with your parents first. All right, first thing you're gonna do is you're gonna take this chocolate and just put a little bit into the bottom of your muffin tin. And you just want enough to kind of cover it like that, to cover the bottom. Then you're gonna put a little bit of peanut butter in on top. And I'm kind of spreading it around so it's all on top of the chocolate. And then you're going to put a little bit of chocolate on top. Now you're going to complete that step until all of your chocolate and peanut butter is gone. And then what you're going to do is stick this in the freezer for maybe 30 minutes, an hour. And what comes out is this delicious finished product. And I'm just going to take it out of the muffin liner for you to see how yummy this looks, the chocolate and peanut butter layers. And trust me, it's delicious. So I hope you'll try this recipe at home and have a lot of fun doing it. And until next time, love God and love others.